Here we are again, folks. So proud to be with you. I am going to do an excerpt right here on chapter 1 of the book of Romans. Chapter 1 of the book of Romans. The book of Romans, if you please, is a constitution for the Christians. All the chapters, the 16 chapters of the book of Romans, are to the Christian. And the Christian is to be an entity in the country he lives in. Whatever country it is you live in, if you are a Christian, you are in a minority in that country as a general rule, as a Christian. And you are to be a Christian nation, a group of Christians are to be a Christian nation inside of the nation they live in. It just so happens I'm in the United States of America. The United States of America is called a Christian nation, contrary to the fact that it is not a Christian nation, but there are still a group of Christians in America. Now, what is a Christian? A Christian is a person set apart to be Christ-like. How do you be like Christ? The word is love. The fruits of the Spirit is that you love and you forgive and you live peaceably no matter what happens in all circumstances. You do not retaliate against the world. Jesus did not retaliate against the devil in a wicked way or in a way that was harmful to anybody but the devil himself. And he said, it is written. Now, chapter 1 of the book of Romans, is the first part of it is separation from the world. I was in the world, as Paul was when he was Saul. I was living in the world. I followed the world. I followed the smoking, drinking, lying, cheating, everything that was possible that could be done, just about opposite from God, I did it. I did not fall in to the degradation of homosexuality. But we are going to see in chapter 1, Paul dividing. He is dividing the country. He is dividing the people. He is dividing, got a plumb line, a dividing line in here. And this dividing line is can't be broken. It is set in stone. And God's the one that set it in stone. If you have a problem with this dividing line, go to the Bible and take it up with God. You can't take it up with man. Man can't change the thing. There is some key words in this book. And one of the key words is separation. To be separated, set apart from the world. Just like I set myself apart to my one wife for 51 years. She is my one wife. No other woman is to enter into my life in the sense that my wife does. And that's exactly how it's supposed to be with God. No, nothing unrighteous is supposed to enter into you once you have God. Call to service. If you are called to service by the grace of God, when are you called to service? The day you are saved. Jesus stands at the door and knocks. If any man open the door, I will come in and sup with him and he with me, is what Jesus said. Do you know the only knob on that door is on your side? There's no knob on his side. He will not push the door open. He will not force the door open. He will give you the opportunity to open that door. God knocked on my heart for 30 years before I opened the door. I was around the gospel, tried Bible school, tried different things, tried preaching, tried Bible reading, tried things that were of the gospel, but I wasn't saved. And if you're not saved, you can't be in. If you put gasoline in a diesel vehicle, it'll blow up. If you put diesel in a gasoline vehicle, it won't run. They're both fuel. You say, but they're both fuel. Why won't it work? Because it won't work. They're two different types of fuel. And there are two different types of things in this world. And one is sin and one is righteousness. and they do not mix. They absolutely do not mix. Total separation is total separation, one from the other. They are totally different, which he promised beforehand through his prophets and the Holy Scripture. Verse 2 of chapter 1 of Romans. We have a promise from God in the Holy Scripture. And this promise from God is concerning his Son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh. God made mankind and put mankind on this earth in order for Jesus to come as the seed of David. It had to be protected and brought through all the way down through the Bible. And that is a big study in itself. We won't go there today. Who was declared the Son of God? The power by the resurrection from the dead. This is the thing that set our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, in Christianity, the head of Christianity. What set it apart is that our Savior did go to the grave, yet he rose again. He came up to live forever, to never die again. Show me any, I don't care, other than Jesus Christ, show me any other religion in the world where the leader of that religion went to the grave, rose again, and is still walking around, and is still living today. And on top of that, living in every person that accepts him as their Savior. The Son of God, the power of resurrection from the dead, according to the Spirit of holiness. There are two spirits in this world. There is the Spirit of holiness and the Spirit of unholiness. And the Spirit of unholiness we're going to see in the second half of chapter 1 of the book of Romans. The Spirit of unholiness goes all the way to the degradation of a human being, to the worst possible level. It doesn't just go to stealing, lying, cheating, all that little small stuff. No, it goes to the giving up of the flesh to vileness, to uncleanness, to throwing in the face of God the things that you do that are vile, that are not right. If you throw those things in the face of God, to whom we have received grace and apostleship to be about the obedience of the faith among the Gentiles for his name's sake. For God, for Jesus Christ's name's sake, are we to be holy, and we are. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole world. Wow! Your faith. By the way, you're looking at a man with no education, and the faith that I have in God, God has allowed me to get on this YouTube. And these things are worldwide. They're known around the world. I used to go to a church called Oakside Baptist Church. It has a radio station, 90.9. You can find it. It streams live on your computer. 90.9, WOAK, LaGrange, Georgia. And you can get it. And they stream live all over the world. By the way, the procurer of that place, The man, Brother Ralph Taylor, is in heaven now, a wonderful follower of God, a disciple, a faithful man in the Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. And he started that, and here it is, still going now today. Look, first I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed. Wow. Paul was somewhere else, and he saw these Roman people that he had written to, that he had visited. He sees their faith in some little church he started, walked into that place, started a little church, and their faith is continuing on. For God, whom I serve in my spirit, in the preaching of the gospel of his Son is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you. He's saying, I'm not just joking with you fellas. I'm telling you something. That the very God of heaven, the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, is my witness. That I pray for you continually. Can you say that to anybody, about anything? Can you say that about anything? God is your witness that you continually pray for somebody? Be careful when you say God is your witness. Wow. Because your witness can be a condemning witness in great judgment if you're lying. Do not lie. Do not lie. Oh, man. For I long to see you, in order that I may impart some spiritual gift to you, that you may be established. Wow, he sees them already established. He sees them already. But he's saying, look, I know a thing or two that I can tell you that will help your establishment, that will increase your establishment, that will give you some things that you need. And that I may encourage together with you while you are each of us by the other's faith, both yours and mine. He said, I'm going to come there and you're going to encourage me in what you know and do. And I'm going to encourage you in what I know and do. Can you meet another Christian and encourage each other? Can you meet another Christian and encourage each other? That's what Paul's saying to do. Be an encourager here. Be an encourager of the faith. I do not want to be unaware, brethren, that often I have planned to come to you and have been prevented thus far. Wow. He wanted to come. His heart's desire was to come, but he was prevented. Order that I might obtain some fruit among you also, even as among the rest of the Gentiles. Wow. Do you know that when Paul was prevented, he was prevented by circumstances, sometimes in bonds, in jail, sometimes by hunger, sometimes by, he had to actually literally stop at one time in his ministry, and he was originally a tent builder. He had the ability to build a tent. And he had to actually stop and build a tent to receive some pay so that he could get some food. That is a bad mark on the Christian. A bad mark on the Christian. I have of late become aware that we have a home missionary in our home church. And this home missionary is living by what God provides him through the peoples of the church. And because of that, he needs support. We may send, and we do, send out to 80, 90 missionaries all over the world. But if we forget our very own missionary in our church and he goes hungry, we're failing. So we need to be very careful, and you need to be very careful wherever you are that you support those that are in your midst. I am under obligation both to the Greek, to the barbarian, both to the wise and the foolish. Wow. He said, I have an obligation. I meet a foolish man, and my obligation is to tell him about Jesus. I meet a Greek, and my obligation is to tell him about Jesus. I meet a barbarian, and my obligation is to tell him about Jesus. I have this little track in my pocket. It says, if you died right now, do you know for sure you would go to heaven? I pass these out daily, 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 daily. We went to an exclusive, very exclusive, unusual for me to go to an exclusive restaurant. Went to an exclusive restaurant above the means that we normally spend to eat yesterday. Got a chance to witness to the lady that tended us. Got a chance to meet the manager, witness to the manager, and give him one of these tracks. And it has, by the way, on the back of it, PH Tidbits, which is on the computer here. May I put him in my prayer list, and may God reach that man. And see what Paul's saying here? To the very top dog, to the very lowest dog, the barbarian. Be the same to everybody. Don't be any different to the poor man on the street than you are to the rich man in front of you. Be the same. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Wow, man, what a statement. In other words, there is everybody, everybody, and everybody. Wow. Look, for in the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. I'm sitting here looking at you and telling you that I was going to do a little study in the book of Romans. I'm in Romans chapter 1, setting the format for the book of Romans, and I'm not telling you what I wanted to tell you was to observe the words. Observe the words that are in here. My Bible is so written up right here, I can't hardly see the words from the study. Verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Chapter 1 and verse 18 is beginning to be a dividing line coming in here in the book of Romans. Remember, the book of Romans now is the constitution of the Christian. It is also about living like Jesus himself. If, the Bible says if, the word if, and the word if here, I've got it written down in a big if, and a big thing behind it. If, this is saying, if you will you? If you will you? The question is will you? And I say if, you will capture. You will have no problem, forward or backwards, the words in God's holy word. You will have no problem going forward or backwards if you will capture the words that Paul uses in chapter 1 here. And throughout, all the way to chapter 5, 1 to 5 is set apart as a segment. It's the first segment of the book of Romans, 1 to 5. And then 6 to 9. And then 9 to 11. And then 11 to 16. So you must learn it that way. You must first read through the book. Read through the book. Read chapter 1 quickly and without looking at it. Just read through it. And then read through it as a study. Get you some good study books. Number 2. A. It is a book of remembrance. It is a plumb line. The book of Romans is a plumb line, a straight plumb line across the Bible. And if you'll get it, you will be correct in your interpretation of the rest of the Bible. You will understand any of God's word by which you study. I have a serious problem that I can't read my own writing. And that's a problem for me. I can write it down, and I can't read my own spelling. So I have a problem with my own notes. So therefore, I have to use a lot of other people's notes sometimes where the words are correctly spelled, and I can cipher them out. Verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. This is our dividing line right here. This is our dividing line right here. Unrighteousness and righteousness. This is the Christian going up to heaven and the lost man going to hell. Here it is. Verse 19. Because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. Wow. God made it evident to me for 30 years that He was God, that He wanted me to go His way. I went the other way. God did not let me fall in to the degradation of uncleanliness, which He's going to talk about right here. For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes, His eternal power, His divine nature has been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse. For even though they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculation, and their foolish heart was darkened. When you get a foolish heart, your heart will be darkened. Now, their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. Professing to be wise, they became fools. Verse 22. Look back at Noah and the ark. 1656 years after God created the heavens and the earth, He had to bring a flood on the earth and kill all but eight people. All but eight people had given themselves over to the lust of the flesh. To the lust of the flesh. This was one evil world. I'm here to tell you, this was an evil world. Wow. And it's going to be again. It is going to happen again. Just before Christ comes and takes the Christian out of here, the Christ-like people out of here, is going to be like that. The exchange of people is going to be corruptible and in front of an incorruptible God, in the form of corruptible man and of birds and four-footed animals and crawling creatures. Man has not just tainted himself. He's tainted the animals. He's tainted the birds. He's tainted things. To teach a parrot to curse. To teach a parrot that can talk and teach him to curse. My goodness. Let's go back. Verse 24. Therefore God gave them over to the lust of their hearts, to impurity, that their bodies might be dishonored among them. For they exchange the truth of God for a lie, and worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, who blessed forever. Amen. Listen, the creature rather than the Creator. We have people today worshiping everything under the sun but the Creator of the sun. And the Creator of the sun, they worship nobody but me, he says. Worship nothing or nobody but me. That's what he said. And here, we have people worshiping other things. Now in verse 26 is, for this reason God gave them over, to discarding passions, for their woman exchanged the natural function for that which is unnatural. We see all over the world today licensing being ordained and put out for the same sex people to marry each other and do that which is not convenient in the eyes of righteousness and the eyes of God. Just as they didn't see fit to acknowledge God any longer. God gave them over to a depraved mind. I'm here to tell you, a man that marries a man, a woman that marries a woman, have a depraved mind. Their mind has got depraved, and they are outside of the ability of God to be able to reach them anymore. Being filled with all unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, evil, full of envies, murder, strife, deceit, malice, they are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, arrogant, boastful, and intruders of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding, unworthy, unloving, unmerciful. And although they know the obedience of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but also give heartily approval to those who practice them. Those that are approving a license for two men or two women to get married are in the same exact likeness as those people who are doing those things. And more than likely, those people who are doing those things have brought some of their own kind up into the higher echelon, so it's their very own kind that are bringing forth this. And that kind is a kind that is going to spend hell, eternity in hell, burning forever with the lust of the flesh, with the pride of life, and the things that they desire to do, yet never being able to ever touch another soul or another person or another anything, by themselves floating in hell fire for eternity with a burning desire to do those things which they do and have no ability. Wow, hell is a wicked place. It is a place for the damned. It is an abyss for the damned, and there will be millions there. It is already overcrowded. By the way, let me tell you a little story. You do not belong in hell. Hell was created for the devil and his angels. A human being's soul goes there. He is an intruder. Hey, if you go to hell, you're an intruder. It was not God's design for mankind to go into the hell that he made for the devil and his fallen angels. And if you go there, you are an intruder. Wow. Man, I tell you what. If there's a place where you do not belong and you all of a sudden show up and walk in there, you find people immediately expelling you, saying, hey, get him out of here. What is he doing in this meeting? He wasn't invited to this meeting. You're not supposed to be in this meeting. And that's exactly what it's like in hell. You are not supposed to be there. You weren't designed to be there. You were designed to go to heaven and be with God forever. And yet you broke the laws of God. And we see the word right here. The word was that they were corrupted. They were corrupted. And because they were corrupted, and right here, verse 23, exchanged. That's the word, exchanged. If you'll study that word out, that's a word with a whole page of meanings. To exchange one thing for another. And that's what they did. They exchanged righteousness for unrighteousness. But before a man goes into degradation and complete unrighteousness, God gives him the opportunity of righteousness. And then he chooses one thing or the other. He can choose to go into unrighteousness, or he can choose to go into righteousness. Whichever he chooses is where he's going to be. Remember now, Book of Romans is a plumb line. It is the knowledge that you and I need to be able to go forward and backward in the Bible. The first five chapters will set us up for several words, all kinds of words: righteousness, wrath, judgment, believe, sin, gospel, Gentiles, God, Jesus Christ, the Spirit, grace, faith, law, justification, unjustification. These are key words in the first five chapters of the book of Romans. All of the spiritual key words are in these first five chapters. If we will get those words, get the first five chapters of Romans in our life, begin to know them, we'll be able to go out and talk to other people about Jesus Christ. We'll be able to pass out tracts. We'll be able to do those things. Our time has come and gone. This is Brother Peter with tidbits from the Word. We will see you next time. May God bless you, and you have a happy life in Jesus Christ. We do pray in Jesus' name. Amen.